Hey everyone! Almost 2 years ago, I created video 78 where we used the Flipper Zero to test the security of various garage doors. My video got a comment recently asking if I could test the Solidremote 202U, confirming it uses rolling codes. People use the 202U because of its long range and ability to control two 6 to 10 amp circuits. Most reviewers said they were controlling garage doors or lighting, but some reviewers have controlled pool pumps, hydraulic lifts, and even a tennis ball machine. In this video, I'll be testing the 202U version 6E, and that version has a four-position dip switch. The 202U implements rolling codes using a key lock algorithm. The manufacturer code is not known to Flipper, so Flipper cannot generate the next code. And the frequency is 372 megahertz, which the Flipper doesn't support. The 202U is invulnerable to both replay and rollback attacks. The receiver has a 64 kilobit ROM and an STC microchip similar to an 8051. I don't know if it's possible to reverse engineer the firmware to determine the manufacturer key. In this video, we'll analyze the security of the remote and receiver using Flipper Zeros, an RTL-SDR, and a logic analyzer. Let's get started! To start our investigation, we'll go into sub-gigahertz, and then we'll choose the frequency analyzer to find out what frequency the remote is running on. We'll press a button on the remote, and we can see we're at 433.8. I think 433.88 to 433.92 is probably about right. Next, we'll click the OK button to start reading on 433.88 megahertz. And I'll actually go ahead and use two flippers to read. And you can see the receiver picked up the signal, as well as our Flipper Zeros. The signal was detected as key lock, and the manufacturer was also detected. This means the Flipper Zero could decode and figure out the current count. And so when we press the OK button, we'll send the next code. We transmitted 5A47, but our receiver didn't pick it up. Watch that signal light as we transmit the next code. This time we transmitted 5846, but again it wasn't detected by our receiver. So next we'll transmit a code using our remote. And that worked, and the transmitted code was 5A47. Do it one more time. And that time we transmitted using 5846. On our second flipper, we can also see the X2, which means it's the second time the flipper has seen both of those codes. So next, I unplugged the power to our receiving module, and I went to read raw on 433.88. Go ahead and hit record, and we'll record pressing the A, and pressing the button a second time. So this recorded the raw timing signals. Then we connected power back to our receiver, and then we tried sending the signal with those raw timings. And we can see the flipper is receiving those signals, but we did not detect any signals. And it was the second time the flipper detected those signals. I tried a few other techniques, such as increasing the data rate, but nothing I tried worked. No matter what I tried, the Flipper Zero couldn't activate the receiver. Even more confusingly, the second remote that I own, which is still in the factory settings, activates the receiver, but the Flipper Zero doesn't detect it at all. The difference is this one was factory, whereas this remote here I have set to work with the 402U and then back to the 202U. I was super confused why it wasn't working, but I decided it was time to use a software-defined radio. So next we plug the RTL-SDR into our computer with the antenna, and we're running GQRX application. And for the frequency, I'm going to change it to 433.88, which is what we saw that signal. Go ahead and start capturing. And now I'll go ahead and press a button on the remote. And that signal definitely looks like on-off keying with one red line instead of two. So that means our modulation is correct. And now I'll switch to the second remote and we'll try that button. The receiver clicked on, but we don't see any signal. So the next thing we're going to do is on the frequency, we'll keep decreasing it and pressing the button and see when we can see a signal. More expensive SDRs show more frequencies at once, so you can do this a little bit quicker. So around 372.44, you can see it's slightly higher than that is where the signal is. And we're able to see the signal from that remote. When we try the other remote, there's also a signal there. So we found a second frequency for the remotes. Over on the Flipper Zero page, we'll click on Docs. And then in the documentation, we'll open the sub-gigahertz tab. Scroll down, click the link to frequencies. And we can see the frequencies is 300 to 348 megahertz. And then it jumps to 387 to 464. So 372 megahertz is outside of the range of what the Flipper Zero can send or receive. And in the US, there's a transmit gap between 321.95 and 433.05. Looking at the 202U, we can see it has an 8-pin RF module, which is probably tuned to 372.44 megahertz. This meant we had to desolder all 8 pins to remove this RF module. So eventually I was successful in removing the RF module and I soldered on a new 8-pin header, and we'll take advantage of that later in this video. On the far right, you can see there's one labeled antenna. The next two pins were ground and then power, and then two pins of ground, and then data out, and then another ground. So we're interested in that data out pin. And over here, you can also see that there was a ground and an antenna, so we could test that all those negatives go to ground. Next, I connected jumper wires to all 8 pins, connected them to a breadboard, and put the module in the breadboard. You'll see that pin 2, that orange wire, has our data, and I move this over to the other side of the breadboard. That goes to probe 3 of my logic analyzer, and then probe 7 of my logic analyzer is that purple wire, which is over here on the breadboard. So again, here's my logic analyzer, and probe 3 is going to that orange wire, and that orange wire is going to our receiver module. And then probe 7 is the purple wire, and that purple wire is going into our radio module. So this means we can see the inputs and the outputs. And I've also just jumpered our inputs to our outputs using this loop wire. Go ahead and run our logic analyzer, and you can see we're getting just some noise from radio frequencies. But when I press the button, we definitely can see a pattern. So this is good news. We'll go ahead and stop that and zoom in on our signal. And here we can see that preamble with that on-off, on-off pattern. Each one's about 200 microseconds. And then there's a 2 millisecond gap. And then after that is our data. So this data looks a lot like key lock data, where we have a long followed by a short, or a short followed by the long. Those 200 and 400 microsecond timings, I don't think are standard. Let me go into the firmware. We'll go into lib, and then sub gigahertz, and then protocols, and then keylock.c. Scroll down, and yeah, we can see that typically in key lock, a short is 400 and a long is 800. Instead, we have 200 and 400. So this actually works similar to a Genie IntelliCode remote. Okay, a quick review. When we press a button on the remote, a 372 megahertz signal is transmitted to this RF module. That data is an output on this purple wire, which then goes on this other purple wire to our logic analyzer so we can see it. And it goes into this loop, which goes on the orange wire. The orange wire goes to the other logic analyzer, probe 3, and then into our receiving module. At that point, the signal gets decoded and the lights turn on and the relay clicks. So now we'll use the GPIO pins on our flipper 0. So I'll move that purple wire into pin A7. And so now our signal is going into pin A7. Pin A6 is going to be our output from our flipper. And so I'll connect an orange wire there, which goes back into our decoding module. So that's our data in and our data out, but we also need to connect a ground wire. So I'll go ahead and pick one of these pins that's ground, and we'll connect it to one of our grounds on our flipper 0. At this point, when we press a button, that data is flowing into our flipper 0 on pin A7, but nothing is flowing out on pin A6, so the receiver does not react. Here's a program I wrote that saves the signal that's on A7, storing it on the SD card as signal-1.rem. I'll hold the button down on my remote so we're transmitting that signal, and then in Visual Studio Code, we'll go to Terminal, Run Task, Launch App on Flipper. Now that application is compiling and running on my flipper. It's reading that code and it just saved it onto the flipper 0. Next, we'll change the code. So instead of saving the signal, we go ahead and load and play that signal. Go to Terminal, Run Task, Launch App on Flipper. It's compiling. And now it just sent the signal and the receiver picked it up. Next, we'll try a replay attack, Terminal, Run Task, Launch App on Flipper, where we'll try to send that signal 1 again. It's compiling, it's transmitting, and nothing happened. So that's great news. If someone is able to capture that signal and retransmit it on 372 megahertz, it will not get picked up the second time. So you cannot do replay attacks to this device. So I've saved a signal 1 remote, and now we'll go ahead and switch to signal 2, and we'll press the button again. We'll go Terminal, Run Task, Launch App on Flipper. And now we'll have that first remote saved, and then the next code is also saved. To validate on rollback attacks, it's usually best to have 3 signals. So I'll go ahead and record a third signal. So we'll do Terminal, Run Task, Launch App on Flipper. There's our third signal. So at this point, we've recorded 3 consecutive signals. And these signals have not been heard by the receiver yet, so they all should be valid. So we'll go back to signal 1 and switch it so that we're loading and playing the signal. Launch App on Flipper and watch the receiver. And there's signal 1, and it just got used. So we cannot replay signal 1. Now we'll do signal 2, Launch App on Flipper. And there's signal 2 getting detected. Finally, we'll do signal 3, Terminal, Run Task, Launch App on Flipper. And now we've transmitted that third signal. Now it's time to try a rollback attack where we'll replay those 3 signals in consecutive order. So this is signal 1 we're replaying. This will usually not get picked up. It will just potentially reset the potential list of counters. So when we do signal two, this is the second code, and sometimes the receivers will resynchronize at this point. And then signal three, this is the moment of truth. If it's resynchronized, the light will turn on. If it hasn't, it'll stay off. And so this means a rollback attack cannot be used on this device as well. So even if someone records multiple signals, they will not be able to attack this device. So we saw that my one remote also transmits on 433 megahertz, and that uses a known manufacturer key, which gives us opportunity to tap into that signal and know whenever someone is pressing a button. If you decide you want this feature, you cannot undo it and go back to factory standards, but hold the C and D together until you get the fast blink and then press A. At that point, your remote will be using the 402U instead of the 202U receivers. This uses FSK, hopping between three different frequencies, transmitting parts of the code on each frequency, and it's using an AES encryption. As you can see, my SDR can capture the full signal, but you would need a custom app on the Flipper Zero to frequency hop. We'll do the CD and A again. And at this point, we're 202U compatible. We're using on-off keying, and we're transmitting a secondary signal on 433 megahertz. So again, the signal at 433 megahertz is using 400 microsecond pulses, which is standard key lock. And our 372 megahertz signal is using about 200 microsecond pulses. So the signals are twice as fast. The Flipper Zero can decode the signal on 43392. However, this is not used to turn on the relays. The Flipper Zero cannot receive or transmit on the 372 megahertz signal, but I used GPIO pins to capture the signal, slowed it down, and then had the Flipper Zero interpret the data. Both frequencies are using the same FIX code, which is like the remote's serial number. The hop data is different, which means the count is encrypted with a different key. The Flipper knows the key on 433 megahertz, but it doesn't know the key for 372, which is used to turn on and off the relays. So again, it appears this receiver is fairly secure and is using rolling codes properly. We haven't looked at the software at all that's running on the receiver. And future versions of the receiver, if they use that 433 megahertz signal, may be more vulnerable to attacks. Please like and subscribe. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below or contact me on Discord.